Okay, here we are, finally, our interview of the day. We got none other than Fireboy DML joining us all the way from Lagos in Nigeria. What?
Yes, sir. One time. What's good, my bro? Big love from Nigeria. Fireboy here. What's good, everybody?
It's what it is, man. Thanks for taking time to join us. And I'm going to start by complaining, bro. I'm like, why haven't you been to Uganda yet? Why not, man?
It's the corona, man. It's COVID-19, you know. I was supposed to be in Uganda earlier this year. I think in middle of this year or something. So, but no worries. We're planning to come bigger, you know. I'm coming with the strength of 2 albums now, so it's going to be massive. You know? Can't wait to be there. The love has been massive ever since, you know, my debut album dropped. So I'm looking forward to seeing you guys, man. Trust.
It is what it is. We're looking forward to that, man. You know how it is. We're looking forward to that.
Yes, sir.
Listen up now. Let's talk about you coming into East Africa. Recently, you were in Tanzania, right? I see you even got some bling from...
Yeah. A bracelet from a close friend in Tanzania. It was smart.
Yeah.
I had a great time.
What was it like in Tanzania? What was the experience like?
It was amazing. You know, normally when I travel out for shows, when I go on tour, city... perform and then, you know, the next day I'm off. But, you know, this time after the show, I spent like a week there. So it was like a vacation for me, you know. So it was really fun. I went to see places. I traveled to Zanzibar, came back, made friends, you know, ate new food, met new people. I love the beach, the waters. The waters in Tanzania are so beautiful, man. Like it's beautiful. And then the people are so nice and so pleasant. So I had a great time. I it was a very unique experience for me because I think that's my first time in Tanzania, and that's my first time I'm actually performing at a city and actually spending some time there with the people. So it was really mad.
I don't know if you've gotten used to it, but are you still in that process of going into a country like Tanzania and you're like, oh shit, they know my music word for word, like, oh my god, this is crazy. Does it still hit you like that, or you're like,
it still kind of does, you know? These days I expect people to, you know my music, but when sometimes I get surprised by the kind of energy, you know, that it comes with. Like throughout the show, throughout all the songs, I performed 14 songs in Tanzania, and all the songs were sung word for word, you know, and that surprised me. That really surprised me, and you know, and I hope it's like that with every city I go to, you know. So that surprises me every time when the end is like 100 from beginning to the end. That really surprises me every time.
All right, cool stuff. I'm going to rewind a little bit and get into your personal life. It's very well known that you're a big lover of poetry. I'll tell you one thing. I used to do a little poetry when I was back in school, but I used to do it mainly to get the girls. Yeah. You know, like, I write a little poem. The girls are like...
We all did that. We all did that. It's fine.
Was that you as well?
Yes, that was me too at first. That was me too. But at some point, it became a sort of escape for me, you know. I was a very lonely kid growing up, so I used to write poems, poetry, dark poems, you know, just by myself, and put them on poetry platforms, and then people were always reaching out and saying, "Oh wow, I love your poems. Your poems saved my life. You know, your words saved me," and you know, stuff like that kind of brought my confidence back, and that was when I started to realize the power of art, and that's when I started to realize that, you know what, I think I might want to go into art, and that's what made me study English. When I got to uni, and then that's when I discovered music, and then the journey just started from there. So yeah.
Well, I don't think it's hard getting girls now. You know, it's like in the bag.
Oh
for
man,
you.
Come on.
Let's talk about you being a little bit of a person. You're very personal, but you're in an industry that is always digging for information. They want you to be public. For example, on social media, is there stuff like you don't put out there, like maybe family, or maybe is there stuff you're like, you know what, this I keep for myself. I don't need people up in this business.
Yeah, I like to be a very private person. You know, for one, I don't really post on social media unless it's very important, or maybe when I just randomly feel like, you know, just want to give them a picture or two. I'm a very private person, and it's not because I'm proud or anything. It's just I like to keep my energy to myself. I don't want to expose myself to too much energy. And I believe that as an artist, what people should really see you for is the art, you know, the music. You know, that's my job. Yeah. Give you the music, just stay out of my personal life. I only let you know what I want you to know. You know, some people can become stans and fans to the extent that, you know, even if you don't say too much, they dig into your life and they know things. That's fine. You know, it's okay. It's okay to be a stan. But I think I my own job is just to give you music. And I think that's what I try to focus on. There's so much focus on my heart. And I don't think my personal life is something that I really like to share that much.
All right. But, you know, social media is a crazy place. I don't know how you deal with it on a personal side, because you do something, you put a song out there, you got a new style or something, and people are bashing you. How do you deal with the trolls? Like, on a personal level, do you read that stuff? Do you not care? How do you deal with it?
The thing is, you cannot avoid not reading. You cannot avoid reading stuff like that. You will always, no matter how much you stay off social media, you always come across stuff like that. Because when you drop a song, the human part of you wants some feedback. Oh, let me see how people react to this. You know, and then in the process, you see the good, you see the bad. You know, over the years, I've developed thick skin. You know, maybe when I was younger in the industry, so a few things got to me. But, you know, these days, I just let things slide and I just focus on the music. And I know that there are fans that really love my music, and that gives me peace. You know, people love my music. I'm making my money. Fam, what am I looking for? I don't care what anybody else has to say, man. Trust me.
Recently on social media, you were asking people for ideas on what to read. You seem to do a lot of reading, right?
I love to read books.
Let's start with now. What are you reading?
Right now, I'm just going back to old books I used to I read in the past. Right now, I'm on to a book, The Venetian Rhapsody by Dennis Robbins. It's a romantic, you know. I just felt like, you know, just delving into it, and you know, I'm having fun so far. But these days, I've been finding out to read books because there's so much attention everywhere. I have to do interviews, I have to do this, I have to make music. So it's not like it used to be before. I miss that 12-year-old me that was always free and just in my room, just reading books and stuff like that. But, you know, I love to do stuff like this because it reminds me of my old life, and it reminds me that I'm human. And apart from being a superstar, you always have to embrace some sides of you that you cannot just let go. So, yeah, I love to read books, but mostly fiction. I love fiction a lot, thrillers.
I'm a big reader myself, and I tell you one thing that I go through. Sometimes I tell my buddies, yo, I'm going back home to read. And they look at me like, yo, what's wrong with you? You get that from people when you say you read. Why do you think our people don't read? Why don't people don't read?
I think it's become something that it got lost along the years. You know, we are millennials, so right now most of us are always on our phones. You know, we do everything on our phones, communicate on our phones. If we even read on our phones, I'm guilty of it sometimes. You know, I read on my phone too. I have books, ebooks on my phone, but sometimes I just prefer the paperback and stuff. But I think it's just it's the times. You know, we are evolving with the times, and you know, we believe that in the bro code, reading books is actually it's not a bro thing to do. It's such a, I don't know, but it's a cool thing for me, you know, reading books. I think that's just it. It's just volume of the times.
Can we hope that one day Fireboy can hit us up with a book club, you know, like Oprah Winfrey, you're like my recommended book
club? I don't think I will do that. I don't think it's that deep. I don't think so.
Nah. Let's go into the music. Let's talk about the music. You started off singing in the choir. It seems like a lot of people start off in the choir. You guys start making some money, everything.
Let me make
and then
one
you're
thing
like,
clear. Let me make one thing clear. It was a short stint. My time in the choir was not up to like, it wasn't up to a week, to be honest. You know, it was just something that my mom tried to convince me to do. And then I was like, okay, let me do it. And then I didn't enjoy it because I didn't like the vibe. I didn't like the fact that I was eating in a group of people and I was singing and my voice wasn't heard. I wanted to be in the spotlight. You know, I wanted to be just me on stage, you know. So I didn't really like the vibe. So the choir wasn't a band for me. It was just something I did for a week and I got tired of, you know. So I've always been a studio guy, trust me. I've always been a studio guy.
We talk Afro life. You are doing something, you started doing something that was different, you know what I mean? That you have to admit it's a little bit of a gamble, yeah? Did you feel that in the beginning that, man, you know, maybe I should do what everybody's doing, or am I taking a huge risk on this side with Afro life?
Yeah, there were doubts, you know, at first. Definitely, there will always be doubts. Even right now, you know, the human side of me doubts some decisions I make. When I started out like the normal Afrobeat artist. Like, I was doing the same thing that everyone was doing. I was sounding like everybody else. And yeah. I didn't know until I realized, and I had to rethink, and I was like, "Guy, you sound like everybody else. No wonder you've not blown up, you know." And then I had to reset, I had to rebrand. And then I just got to work and I just started recording. And then I was convinced that that was the only way for me to blow up, you know, by coming with something different, you know, a different spice. I studied the greats. I studied the ones that came up and blew up. I noticed that they brought something different to the table, you know, and I knew that, you know, that's what I needed. So I focused on my sound. So I brought some lyricism and, you know, soul into my own Afrobeat. Afrobeat is all about the, you know, vibes, and you know, but you know, my version of Afrobeat, even with vibes and the dance, you can notice in vibration, you know, there's so much effort into the writing, there's so much soul in the way I'm singing and everything. So I think with that added spice, that's what I bring to the table. And I was convinced that that's what I needed. There was no doubt about that at all. There was no other way I could blow up, trust me. There's no other way you can blow up as an upcoming artist if you don't bring something different to the table, because there are so many talented people out there doing different stuff. You have to bring something different.
So, Laughter, Tears, and Goosebumps drops, and you know, it's going up the charts. It's going up the charts. Was there a particular point when you're like, "Oh shit, this is actually an amazing album. It's gonna go like"? Was there a point like that when you're like, "Whoa"?
Well, yeah, the point where it got to that for me was when it actually became a success. Like, that was when it actually dawned on me that, oh, okay, this is it. When I was making the album, all I knew was that I was just making music, you know, and I felt good. I was happy. But a couple of days before the album dropped, man, I wanted to die. I wanted to enter the ground and just, I wanted the ground to swallow me. I was like, oh my God, it's coming. These people are going to kill me. This is the end of my life. This is the end of my career. These people are going to, oh my God, I'm done. I didn't feature anybody. What am I doing? You know, there was so much doubt going on. And I'm thankful for Olamide and the strength that he offers, you know. Not just to his artists, you know, and, you know, he just assured me that, dude, this is a classic, you know, those were his words. This is a classic. You don't know what you've done. This is a classic, you know. And then the album dropped, and then that night I received overwhelming love, like, everywhere, you know. We went to the club to celebrate. I didn't like Scatter when I recorded it. We went to the club to celebrate. I heard Scatter in the club. I was like, What? You know, and then that's when I started to realize that, you know, I actually made an amazing album. And then months later into the whole thing, I knew that, yes, I have a modern classic in my hands, you know, and I'm really grateful to God for that. It's some crazy shit.
You know, working with Olamide, and we'll go back to the beginning. Maybe you're kind of used to it now, but beginning, like those first days, where you're meeting up with him and your legs are shaking, you're like, yeah, you know, was it?
Yeah, that's how it was. That's how usually is when you meet superstars, you know, especially superstars that have been doing it the game for a long time, like the OGs, you know. So, but there's a way it makes you feel comfortable when you're around him. So, even as I was G3 and all that stuff, you know, he made me feel comfortable with him. So, I had a clear head when I was talking to him in person, and then we got talking. He got to understand my plans. I got to understand his own plans. And then it was so easy. You know, we started working on the joint album where Jealous came from. And, you know, it was beautiful, man. Trust me.
Speaking about getting starstruck, everybody gets starstruck. Have you got starstruck recently, last couple of years? Have you met somebody and you're like, yo, selfie, selfie?
Yeah. When I met one day at the show. Mandy is my idol. Wanda Cole is my idol. Trust me. Everybody knows that. Every one of my fans knows that. You know. So I met him at the show. It was so unassuming. It was just there. We were just sitting there backstage, and I like, good evening, sir. And I shook his hand, and he's like, oh, what's good? Wow, Wanda Cole. You know, I couldn't even ask for a picture. You know, it was amazing for me. I think that was the last time I got starstruck. You know, but these days, I don't know, man. I see people and I just greet them. I just say hi. I'm a superstar, man. But when I meet an idol,
I hear you.
Give them the respect. Yeah, you know. So
you know, is there, are you still looking, you know, like to working with certain people? Are there some people you think maybe from Africa, maybe from the world, like, yo, you would drop me in studio with these guys, Pasenda, whatever, it would be magic, you know?
Definitely, definitely. You know, apart from my idols that I look up to, Wandeko, I've worked with Wandeko already. I would love to work with him 1,000 times over again. I love John Bellion. I don't know if you know him.
I love
Pasenda. You know, those people are, they mean a lot to me. I literally have their pictures hung on my walls back home, you know. I love Travis Scott. I would love to work with him, you know. Countless other people too, you know, Afrobeat pioneers, Whiskey, Davido, Burna Boy, all of them. I would love to work with a lot of people, so many talented people. And that's one of the things I'm working on for next year. Apart from my tour, I'm also working on more collaborations, you know, for the fans. I want to give them everything, man. I want to give them all of me. You know, I've had a solo run for a while now, and I feel like it's only right that I give them collaborations. So,
yeah,
there'll be more of that next year.
All right. You know, speaking about music, there's been a lot of new music dropping recently. Is there stuff you've been listening to that you've been having on repeat, you know, your albums or EPs that dropped and you're really loving?
Yeah, I listen to music randomly, you know, as long as it's good, I listen to it. I just bump to it. And this year has been a year of albums, especially in the Afrobeat scene, especially in Nigeria, you know. So all the albums that I've dropped this year from Nigerian artists, I'm rinsing every single one of them. I've listened to every single one of them, and they're all amazing. Everyone's on their toes. Everyone's doing great. So, yeah, Nigerian music first, yeah. And apart from that, it's just random music all over the world. African music, East African music, South African music, Oriental music, European, you know, pop, you know. So I listen to music randomly. I can't really pinpoint.
Let's talk Apollo. You know, that's the Greek god of music. Are you into Greek mythology? Is this your kind of thing?
Yes, my man. I've been into Greek mythology since I was a kid, man. Like, I was obsessed, literally obsessed. Like, I was so obsessed and I wanted it to be real so bad. And even till today, I still kind of subconsciously think it's real. Like, it exists. Olympus and the Greek gods, you know. So yeah, it's definitely that part of that. I really fucks with Greek mythology. So yeah, that's one thing.
looking at you know the mythology and all of that in general, astrology, aliens, is that you believe in that kind of stuff?
It's not that deep. To be honest, I don't believe in star signs. That's for one. I believe that if you are this kind of person, you are that kind of person. If you're a shitty person, you're a shitty person. Don't blame it on stars, man. Like, don't do that. I don't believe in star signs. But I don't believe in aliens, too. I believe that, I don't know, well, there might be aliens because there are other planets. That makes sense. But I haven't seen those. But for some reason, I just really love the stories of Greek mythology. The stories of so real, so relatable, so surreal. And you know, for someone who loves words and who's always been a lover of stories and words and stuff like that, I really fucks with it. So that's one thing I know that I believe in, that you know, it's not real.
Yeah,
I'll take myself that. So yeah, when I named my album Apollo, you know, it was part of that. But it was mainly because after my debut album, my fans put me on this pedestal, like, wow, this guy dropped 13 tracks, didn't feature anybody, and it's a modern classic. Wow, what has he done? This is crazy. This guy is a god. Yeah. Blah, 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 blah. Like, okay, is that the energy you guys want to... Okay, let's do it. So I kind of put myself in that god mode, and I felt like, am I a god now? Is that what's going on here? You know, and that was the mind space I was when I was making that album, you know. But as much as I titled the album after a god, the album actually talks about my flaws as a human being. So that irony is what makes the album special to me.
You seem to be singing to the ladies, and you know, we use your music to get the ladies.
You're welcome, bro.
You know what I mean? I'll name some of my kids after you.
Do you? That'd be nice.
when you're on social media, you know, like any other guy, you might be scrolling down, you see somebody you like, but you know, your fireboy DML, do you slide up in the DM? Do you like the picture, but you're scared of a screenshot? How did it work in your world, man?
I never slide in DMs. I never slide in DMs. I vibe. I like pictures. You know, I do like pictures if I really like the person. But I never slide in DMs, fam. I don't know how to do it. I don't respond to DMs. I don't slide into DMs. I respond to DMs very on rare occasions, you know, maybe when the person is really important enough and I feel like, okay, maybe it's business stuff. But I believe that if I meet you in person, if it's meant to be, then I'm going to meet you in person. And if I meet you in person, then I'm going to get you.
It is what it is, man. I want to thank you very much for joining us one more time. We look forward to having you in Uganda as well. And as you wrap it up, off the album, Apollo, is there a song or maybe two, three that specifically talk to you that is, that, you know, like, this is my song on Apollo?
Yes. Three songs. Straight Up, Champion, Tattoo, and Remember Me. Special songs to me, man. Special songs.